The state of Nagaland is rich in diverse tribal cultures. Our experience of the beautiful terrain, the bedroom of nature, the warmth and hospitality offered by Nagas was on the first day of our workshop, we headed towards Kisama village. The heritage village is actually a model village established and commissioned by the state government as an effort to keep the Naga traditions alive. The entire fabric of the village is designed in a traditional Naga village form to give it an authentic feel. It basically consists of 16 replica houses of the tribal houses built in the vernacular, the traditional form by the tribals themselves. The houses are predominantly made of timber, bamboo, and thatch. Every house had its own, tribal house had its own distinctive feature that distinguished strongly their cultural life and lifestyle. The roof profile basically had a small roof that peeped out from the shadow of the main roof, probably to protect the entrance as the main roof projected quite high. This was very typical characteristic of every tribal house, and every tribe used it in a very distinctive way. They had created their own ways to get the feature. They experimented with the forms also. The same roof profile was used with curves where the veranda was semi-roof. These are some of the tribal maroons that they are going through. We couldn't cover all the 16 maroons, but we have this is another tribal house. The two bamboo that form the gather of pranch to form the horns on top. This was another typical feature of every Naga house. As said before, the architecture strongly dictated their cultural life. The signature profile that is used above the house was actually to signify the status of the house owner in the village. And besides being experts in bamboo, they were quite well skilled in timber. You can see well carved columns and mottos. This is another tribal house. Another tribal house for Kachari, Northern. Again, we see well carved bamboos and mottos. These are the other tribal houses. The entrance to this specific maroon was very dramatic. It had a steep stair which was carved out of a wooden block with a human salem block, and the rope hanging from top was actually used as support to climb up the house. The heads of these were locally known as Bikins, wooden heads. Besides being used as decors, they signified dominance of the house in society. These are some examples of the wooden carving that we had. They were used as decors and also had symbolic meaning, like the formal represents a wedding, the foods represented wealth, elephants and tigers for power. Head hunting was a very common tradition in Nagaland. It is said that the owner of the house who had most number of heads hung outside his house was elected as a chief and was liable to throw feasts or parties in the village. This is a very unique bamboo jari that we found in one of the maroons. A vernacular detail to tie up the post to the beam. The post has a neatly neat groove around it to hold the beam of it. This is a picture of the underside of one of the picture of the underside of the thatched roof. Here you see various national details that we use. Split bamboo deck flooring. Here is its utilitarian purpose. This is a picture taken from, actually a picture from a typical house in Nagaland. The gaps between the flooring actually had functional use. They could just swept off the dust or the leftover food so it could fall down and they would see it could get rid of it. We also had the opportunity to visit our actual live village in Nagaland. It's a Kigwama, the village is known as Kigwama village. Here, the traditional art of making bamboo houses is thatched roof was replaced by metal sheets, though these superstructures still used bamboo. However, the traditional form had not died and not died out completely, and birds were still made to maintain the traditional form. Their horns were still there, motifs and all were still made. This is one of the pictures, zoom in pictures of the houses where we saw Mithun made the stack in a low S trophy. This should definitely be the chief's house of the village. Picture showing cluster of houses. This is split bamboo wall. The nodes actually formed a very interesting pattern that etched these depths of it. This is the gallery of it, picture of one of the interiors of the house. This is Kohima, the city state. The image is captured from the terrace garden of the lamps in the city. The city is located on a hilly terrain, showcases of breathtaking beauty at dusk, though densely populated. But the gallery is, there is all a portrait jungle in Nagaland on a land which was once of bamboo, beautiful and versatile material. The bamboo houses are replaced with the concrete buildings in the name of modernization. And this development has mostly taken place in the last 10 years. He is architect Richard Bell, who was also associated with bamboo trade, and he introduced bamboo in Nagaland to us. He is one of the many people who is trying to revive the tradition of making bamboo houses in Nagaland. He has built quite a few structures in bamboo, and presently is working on a groundless green building which will be entirely made of bamboo right in the heart of Kohima City. Second day of our workshop, we headed towards Nagaland Bamboo Resource Center in Dimapur. The resource center is established by the Naga government in 2005 basically to preserve the traditional techniques of making bamboo craft and houses. It has set up many facilities for demonstration and production of bamboo craft. Due to our hectic schedule of 4 days workshop, we couldn't explore much of the place around, but we will go through some of the bamboo setup. Is a park set up in NBDA, which showcases various species of bamboo in India. Then they had a bamboo mat production and making center. Bamboo charcoal bamboo. And these are some of the products that we came across in the center. Really amazing products of bamboo. Bamboo table, skin and bottom, bamboo jam, chair, these are, I think, Vishal is going to use. These are some of the landscape features that they had around. They also had a bamboo central mostly where they sell and
This short introduction about bamboo. Bamboo is basically a grass, and the bamboo plant varies from a height of 1 feet to a timber bamboo that is around 100 feet and about more than 100 feet. Bamboo basically can grow in any climate, in any terrain type, or be it plains or mountains. Yeah, bamboo grows in various landscape types. And basically, the bamboo is a very is widely grown around the world. So then you have basically two types of bamboos. That one is called Brahmas, that spread widely, and they spread widely, and they're very they infest landscapes and things like that. And then you have clumpers that grow from a particular source, and then they spread from that. So clumpers are basically found in tropical landscapes, and you have and in temperate landscapes you find runners. Those are the basic two types of bamboo that you know. And bamboo also, as a plant, contains a lot of starch and sugar that makes it very vulnerable to decaying agents. That you have borers and you have fungus attacks that make it a very very vulnerable. Unlike wood, bamboo basically does not have toxins that can fight against these decaying agents. So that's why we need to protect bamboo and treat it. So those will come to that later. The basic structure of bamboo is, you can see you have the roots, and then you have the structural part that supports all the branches and leaves. That's called the column. This is a section of the column, and the column basically consists of various joints, and the joints are called the nodes that support the structure. And you know, over tall bamboo section, the nodes actually give it a support so that it doesn't buckle. So node is actually the solid part of the bamboo. And you have the areas between the node, which is called the internode, that is a more flexible part that you can drill into, and you can make the joints out there. And in bamboo also is a very very in terms of can be used for decorative purposes, and also it is very very useful in many parts of the world. It's used as food, fodder. So it's also used as a primary building material, and besides that, also you can make many useful things out of it, as you can see. Coming to a few species that are useful to us, tropical species in India. First, we have Bambusa bulbosa. It is a bamboo of Indian origin, and it's commonly found in the northeast. It is known to grow at heights at high altitudes, which makes it grow bigger in size. It grows at a height of around 30 meters, and it has a column diameter of 8 to 15 centimeters. And it's known to be used in the building industry because it's very strong, thick walled, and very sturdy as a bamboo. So it's used a lot in terms of building construction. Next, we have Bambusa tunda. Similar to Bambusa bulbosa, all similar properties, similar in size, and it is widely used in Nagaland to build their structures and in the building construction industry. But the only difference between bulbosa and tunda is the column is more straight, and so you can use it. Bambusa nutans is a loosely plumb bamboo, and here you see it grows around 20 meters tall, and you get the column is mostly straight, smooth, and the typical thickness is around 3 to 5 centimeters, so it's very miniature bamboo, and it is widely used for decorative elements and also basket weaving and things. Next is Dendrocalamus strictus. It is the most commonly found bamboo in India. I'm sure most of you must have come across this species. It's a medium-sized bamboo, and the key factor about this bamboo is that its column is solid, mostly solid, and grows to a height of around 20 meters, and the thickness varies from 5 to 8 centimeters. Dendrocalamus giganteus, the name sums it all, it's like a gigantic bamboo species. It grows to a height of around 35 meters tall, and the column width is around 15 to 30 centimeters. And it's also used in the construction industry, but not so much to build structures, but it's mostly used for scaffolding. Coming to the comparative column diameters, we have the different diameters. You have giganteus at 15 to 30, then you have bulbosa at 8 to 15 centimeters, you have strictus, it's around 5 to 8 centimeters, and you have nutans at 3 to 5 centimeters. What is interesting to see that although giganteus is so huge and it grows so tall, the column wall and the hollow thickness makes it unfavorable to use for structural purposes. Bulbosa is more favorable because you have the column ball to the hollow ratio makes it most sturdy. Whereas strictus, it's solid, the column is solid, it actually it's not used so much because it cannot take so much stress. Coming to propagation of bamboo is a very very important aspect in promoting the bamboo, and at the Bamboo Resource Center, propagation is also is like one of the key parts of the center, which they grow various species of bamboo and they distribute it to various parts in Nagaland. So you have various methods of propagation. You have the tissue culture, you have propagating method, bamboo. tissue culture, the bamboo takes a much longer time to grow to a mature plant. It takes around 8 to 10 years for bamboo to grow to tissue culture. Then you have seed origin, and you have calum cuttings where bamboo grows much faster with these methods. It goes to a mature clump in around 4 to 5 years. Then harvesting of bamboo. Harvesting of bamboo is actually a very key, very important aspect in working bamboo, because one needs to know that you have procured the best material for your work. So that to know how bamboo is harvested is important. So as I mentioned earlier, the bamboo contains a lot of starch and sugary content, because that makes it it's prone to all this to borers and to fungus. So that's the reason bamboo harvesting is you need to make sure that you harvest it at the right point, because the bamboo set to the sugar content and the starch content set to fluctuate on various seasons. So in the dry months, they say that the starch content is the highest during the summer, and the ideal time to actually harvest bamboo is during just after the rains and when the winter just set in. During this time, it's ideal to harvest the bamboo, and also then during this time, it's preferable to harvest bamboo during the nights, during a full moon night. You see, and after harvesting bamboo, you got to treat it, because the remaining starch content that remains in the bamboo, you need to completely remove that out. So that's when you treat bamboo. And traditionally, bamboo was treated by leaching, where they used in Nagaland, they used to take the bamboo and then they used to let it to the river water, and it would get washed and reduce the starch content, and that's how they treated their bamboo traditionally. Here at the resource center, they have incorporated traditional technique of leaching by providing a tank in which they treat the bamboo with a treatment solution of boric acid or borax, which helps reduce the starch content. And after treating the bamboo in the tank, you need to actually dry it. So it's around a seven weeks process of keeping it in the tank. So this is a much slower process as compared to the vacuum pressure treatment. That's a newer technique that is used to treat bamboo. Here, the vacuum pressure treatment, what you do is you have to drill holes in between the internodes. You drill a hole so that when you put insert the bamboo in the chamber, it absorbs all the treatment solution, and that's how then you treat it in the chamber. You see a picture of how the internodes have been drilled. And here is a simple pressure pump that can also be used in cases where you want to treat pressure treat bamboo at a much smaller scale. And here the pressure pump is basically used to pump in the treatment solution, and you have different valves that can accommodate different sizes of bamboo. And then again, this is a much, much smaller scale treatment as compared to leaching. Finally, this is how the greens, the bright green bamboo looks after you have treated it. It's sort of pale yellow, and this is treated bamboo. The average life of treated bamboo is around 10 to 15 years, and it can be more if it's protected well, overhangs and things like that, and also from under. This runs through a sort of a cost analysis of how bamboo can be made sustainable working with you. In the case one, the material is procured from an external source and then it's treated there. The major chunk of the cost is actually in the transportation of bamboo. That drives the price quite high. In the case two, when the material itself is grown on site, that's the beauty of bamboo. You can grow it on site and you can harvest it and use it to build the structure that you want. And you treat it on site itself. Then the major cost of transportation is totally eliminated. here's an example of how a bamboo structure was built on site with the bamboo that was grown right this way. Then we come to a bit of joinery, and here basically the different ways of how you fasten bamboo. You can use a wooden or bamboo plug, and which is a more traditional technique of. And you can use a nut and bolt joint, that is a very recent method of connecting bamboo, which enables you to actually even replace members that are worn out. And also you can lash bamboo, that's a more traditional tactic. Coming to joinery, this is a more like a root, column to root connection of bamboo, where you actually have to drill in the GA board through, and then you sort of pass that a plug that it actually holds on to, so sort of gives it that strength. Then there's a couple of these joinery that we've seen at Richard's office, and the samples that were made to do. And then you have a column to beam connection, and you can see how the one bamboo is given a support of another bamboo so that the beam sort of rests on it. And you can see sort of a plug, bamboo plug, where it also has a dual purpose of holding the bamboo beam and also sort of acting like a point with a lashing to hold on for the lashing. This is another connection technique where you use a metal strap as to hold the bamboo and then a nut and bolt joint. It's another joinery technique where you can use plugs to sort of hold the lashing together. Another technique where you have to drill a hole to sort of tie the knot, the lashing knot. And you can notice the fish moth groups where how the bamboo needs to rest on, and that because generally joint bamboo just one on top of the other, you have to really get the grip. So you need to sort of make a fish moth groove in the bamboo that sort of helps the bamboo rest. J-bolt joint where the J-bolt is holding onto this nut and bolt there. Go to India to explain a couple of structures that we saw in Nagaland.
So we've picked two structures that we would like to share with you, mainly because of the way they interested us and the elements and the way bamboo was used. So this was on the way to Dimapur from Kolkata, and this is a structure called Shabru, and it's basically a boutique shop, so and a lifestyle store. What is interesting about this structure is that the deck that is here, it is kind of resting on the steeper side of the slope, and one part of it is propped mainly from that slope. So this image actually of the structure, it inspired us when we wanted to build the hands-on structure later in the next 2 days. That's why I'm showing it to you. So, yeah. This is the interiors of it. Now you can see that the trees that there were on site are actually going through the structure. This is another interesting thing because of the medium of roof that architect Bello has decided to use here, is that the bamboo batons and the columns basically enable for this, and the thatch as well. The foundation from the structure is it's interesting actually because what he has done is there's a concrete base, and onto that is this wooden member that is immersed in it, and much higher is the bamboo that is bolted to the wooden member. So the wood is a stronger wood, and that rests in the foundation basically, and the bamboo is not in direct contact with the concrete, and what is around is basic stone masonry around the structure. This was one of the interesting points of the structure. Then over here you see that from that base, the wooden plug, the bamboo being propped, and if you notice the way there are two members. Like, there's one that is propping the roof, and there's one above it, which is over there, that is holding the batons from the roof itself. Now we asked him why do you have to use two different things? Why can't you just use one? But the interesting fact is that say a part of this bamboo was to rot, and if you had to replace it without making the structure weak, it would still happen because there are two methods of distributing the load. So if the baton on top had to be replaced, it could be done because the structure is still stable. Another interesting part was that over here you can see I have Noah explained earlier Bambusa nutans is used as part of a jali over here, and it's traditionally mashed. Another interesting part of the shop what I liked was the way the racks were done. So yeah, the bamboo column and on it resting the shorter bamboo members which are bolted. The roof over here, the roofing was done to this thatch of a local palm that is found all across Nagaland. Mm-hmm. And this was an interesting experimentation kind of thing where he used the tensile nature of the bamboo over here. So it was just like a playful entrance into the deck. The bamboo shell. Now this was a structure that was done by a couple of Spanish architects in the Bamboo Resource Center, and they took over 3 months to do this. And what is interesting about it is that they've used the bending and tensile nature of bamboo for this structure, and it interestingly also houses weaving crafts inside it. So we'll just run through this. We didn't get much time around this particular structure, but it is a very interesting one, so I'll run through the slides. So can see like the clumps of bamboo tied together to form the main structural of this. You can see even over here, very much like how you would make a basket, but a bigger version of it. Okay, so this picture is basically a typical rodent polyma. And if you notice, it's a hilly terrain. So on one side, there's the valley and there's the road. So when they asked us that you have two days to build a hands-on structure, we thought it would be interesting because we walked a lot in Kohima, and there was hardly, some places were lucky enough to have footpaths, but other places was directly the road. So we decided maybe we can put up like a small bus stop there. So the idea came up from like Ibn Shapiro, how it had the deck propped up. We wanted to do something like that. So the bus stop, a small bus stop module, would be one side, so off the road and cantilevered and propped from the other end, basically. That was the conceptual sketch that we had in mind. So when we went, so this was now on the second half of the day. And when we got there, architect Richard told us that all the workers at the Bamboo Resource Center, usually before they execute anything, they make a model of it. What this does is when you make a model, it helps you realize how much of bamboo you need. It helps you visualize the kind of joint you may have to make for it. And it basically reduces on wastage, and you don't have to, you get it. Model making, it helps. So we got down to making our models. So we asked them, what is the standard size of a bamboo that's available? And they said 20 feet. So for our model, what we had was, after we made a little structure, we came up with dimensions like 7.5, 9.5, 6 feet. This was because of, when you're making the model, you want the slope, you want those kind of things. But we quickly changed 9.5 to 10 feet because it's a 20 foot long bamboo. So when you say 9.5, you're wasting that other 5 where you're going to use that small piece, or unless you can use it for something else. But basically, to reduce wastage, we decided to get into multiples of 2 and even numbers. So you can split the 20 foot in 2. We calculated how much we would need because this was required. We had to give the organizers the amount of bamboo we need. So we had to calculate it in. So that was one of the initial models that we had made. And this was, we put it also at the edge of the table to
tell them how we would like it to be propped up and member of a certain diameter, like Noah explained, there are different kinds of diameters. So for the base, you would require a thicker diameter. For the roof, maybe a lighter member, so a smaller diameter. So we have wanted things like that, but they, in the end, we worked with just one standard diameter for the whole structure. So it's labeled basically, and it's labeled on the structure as well. So this is the end of the model that we finished on the second day. So now on the third day, we had to devise how we're going to go about building the structure. So we didn't have a sloped land over there. We didn't have a drop on a valley for us to prop it up. So we had to do it on a flat surface in any case. But we still wanted that inclined railing. So we said we'll do that, we'll prop it up. So that was the basic sketch of what we required to do. And we started off with laying down the bamboo, you know, getting it at right angles. So the tools available over there that they used was the simple chisel and the hammer. This was basically for joints, like to chip them. They used a very interesting saw. It's called the compound saw. Over here you can actually adjust the angle that you want. So if it's a mitered end like this, like that corner over there, you can cut it to 45 degrees. You can pre-position the angle and cut it to 45 degrees. Now this can also be done with your regular saw, but this ensures, you know, precision. This is what they were using there. They were using cutters and grinders, like Noah explained earlier, for the fish mouth joints. You would have to perfect that, so it would rest perfectly. They would smoothen it up also. And the handle for the bolts. So yeah, so the base, measured it at right angles, put it together. Now bamboo is hollow, right? So if you're going to put a bolt in it, it has to... If it has to be more compact and compressed, it should go through a plug preferably, so that it has more, you know, because it's hollow, so it has more surface. So this was the first joint we made, which was an epic failure actually, because this member that you see there, and we put the plug into this one, and we decided to bolt it, but immediately it just slid off. Now the workers who were there actually were telling us, don't do this, it's not going to work. But we said, no, okay, let's try. We are the architects, let's try. Let's figure this out ourselves, let's see how it works. So from this, I would like to tell you that no matter how many models you make, and no matter how many joints and pictures of joints you see on screen and in books, once you actually hold the bamboo in your hand, once you actually are down with the bamboo, then you know, what needs to be done and what needs to be done. Now, I could have drawn this out and said, oh, it works fine, but it doesn't. And we could have stuck it with Fevibond on our models and it would work fine, but it doesn't. So this was that. So then this kind of joint was done at the end, where you see the mitered end, and they use the compound saw to get compact. And then for the base, the cross member that you found the sketch, that was done. This was the best method either, but we just had 2 days. So we couldn't spend much of time on figuring out what is the best thing to do. So at the end, by the end of the day, we had this down and we had to prop it up to, you know, get the angle right and all of that. So by the end of the day, we had this done. Now the second stage was getting the frame up. So in this, what we had done is we put the members on the floor, and the same drawing that we had used in our model, we drew it on a paper and we got the angle out of it. That is the way we went about doing it. And after we did this, the second stage would be to join the roof onto the base with this. So after a lot of trouble and getting a few more, initially there were just like 2 guys helping us, and we had to call more boys to help us to prop the frame up and everything. And after getting it to a parallax is when you look at it and it should be, you know, concentric in a certain way. Concentric in a sense, you know, should be seen that it's parallel to each other. After we did this, they realized that they had put it the wrong way, because it was actually supposed to be mirrored and that side was supposed to be on the other side as per our sketch. But we put it the wrong way, so we had to take it off again. And we're already down to the first day, and we just have one more day to go. So we took it out and we turned it around, we put it back again. So this was another thing that we learned, that your paper and you show do it in the model, right? When you have these complex angles and you're working with them, you have to make sure that you supervise the way it's done and you're basically aware of how you go about doing it. So after that was done, then we decided we have to tie both these frames together so they're more stable. Now the next step was getting the slope proof onto this. Now before that, these guys, we were working and we just had like the end of the day to complete the structure. And they started putting like bamboo to, you know, they started putting scaffolding and extra members to support it. And we're like, what are you doing? We have just like, we just have some more time to go. We have a few more hours to get the roof up. And why are you all putting so many extra members? And then we were like, ma'am, how do you expect us to climb onto the structure if there's no scaffolding? And that's when we hit us again. You need to listen to the people who are working with the bamboo also, because they are the ones in the end who are doing the labor for you. Then down to the scaffolding. So the roof was done the same way we did the frame. We did it on the slope first, bolted it, and then we passed it around to the guys and attached the same nut and bolt happens. So at the end of the workshop, that was what we had. That was just the basic frame at the end of the days that we had of the bus stop that we had in mind. Though we would have liked to see it finished like this and seen a nice seat done and probably done a little more clashing on it, we didn't have the time to do that. So this is a picture of the local house in and that was at the end of the day. In the last hour, we had like initially we worked with just two people. And by the end of that day, because we needed to get the roof up and everything, almost all the guys on the site came to help us.
And finally, just to sum up everything and sum up working with bamboo basically, what are the issues that we face while working with bamboo? Firstly, the issue of joinery. As Ria said, that you know, you might visualize a joint in some way, but then when you get it on, start working with it, you realize the problem. Then the treatment of bamboo. You know, within the constraints, how do you treat the bamboo and transformation to fight. So one interesting thing was told to us by Richard Bellu. I mean, he said that they would want to transport their bamboo in Nagaland. They were to do on the case, they would cut it like right on the field fire, what you would do. Then the truck would be like an empty truck would be returning back to Dimapur. They would get it loaded with the bamboo and send it back. So that is like much cheaper way of getting their material. So that is one way you can cut down on transportation the site. Then a replacement of worn out and broken members. As we have said, that extra support, you know.